Australians will soon learn the date for the federal election, with the Prime Minister expected to start the official campaign behind in the polls. Let's go live now to politics reporter Eliza Edwards. Eliza, Scott Morrison has taken his pre-election blitz to Melbourne.
He has, Lizzie. He'll soon arrive here at Melbourne's Synchrotron, a major technology research hub, to announce a $23 million investment in medical manufacturing. Over the weekend, he was selling his wares in Tasmania while his opponent held a political rally in Brisbane. All signs point to an election campaign in full swing, but the Prime Minister will visit Government House this week to make it official. Still, the opinion polls aren't going his way. An Ipsos survey in the Financial Review today showing Labor has a 10-point lead over the coalition, while in news poll the government appears to have enjoyed a small bounce off the back of the budget. Its primary vote has risen to 36%, at the same time Labor's fell to 38%. Despite the gap narrowing, the opposition leader thinks he might be in the box seat.
Queenslanders are telling me that this is a tired old government that's out of ideas and out of time. They want a change. They want a government that actually has a plan for a better future, not a plan that's divided, not a government that is just arguing.
Lizzie, the character of both leaders will be a big feature in the upcoming election campaign. Scott Morrison's ministers were out defending him this morning after historic claims resurfaced about a brutal pre-selection fight in 2007 in which he allegedly used the Lebanese background of a rival against him, claims he strongly denies. One minister shrugging off the 15-year-old allegations while turning the attack back onto Labor.
This character assassination stuff is just the titillations of Canberra. When the ruler gets run over, Anthony Albanese, I think we'll start to see Mr. Anthony Albanese and the real Anthony Albanese come out to shine, and they'll be somewhat disappointed.
It's not long until Australians will have their say. We should know within days whether the election will be called for May 14 or the 21st. Lizzie?
Eliza Edwards there for us in Melbourne. Tens of thousands of Australians can roll up their sleeves from today for a fourth COVID jab ahead of an expected surge in cases in winter. Christina Hearn reports.
From today, vulnerable Australians will be able to get their second booster shot. That includes people over the age of 65, Indigenous Australians over 50, those who are immunocompromised, and people living in aged and residential care. More than 190,000 Australians are eligible from today. That will jump to 1 million in May. You do have to wait 4 months between your first and second booster shot. You can book via your GP, pharmacy or vax clinic. The government-funded flu vaccine will also be available. Meanwhile, the Victorian government is under new pressure to scrap the isolation rules for people deemed close contacts. Richmond coach Damien Hardwick has weighed in after youngster Sydney Stack missed a VFL match considered a close contact.
If we could just get rid of the close contact rule, Dan, that would be terrific, make everyone's life a hell of a lot easier.
The Victorian Premier returns to work today after recovering from COVID.
Australia's response to COVID-19 will be scrutinised in an independently funded inquiry. Former top public servant Peter Shugold will lead the inquiry to investigate how governments can better handle future health crises. Nine's newspapers are reporting Andrew Twiggy Forrest's Mindaroo Foundation, the Paul Ramsey Foundation and the John and Miriam Wiley Foundation will fund the inquiry. More than 6,000 people have died from the virus in Australia. Help is on the way for New South Wales flood victims, with residents in some local government areas to receive a $20,000 grant to help with fixing up their homes. Nine's Eddie Meyer joins me on the desk this morning. Eddie, Premier Dominic Perrottet is in Lismore today.
Yeah, Lizzie, he's returned from 2.5 weeks of parental leave and he's made Lismore his first stop. Now, he's wanted to see for himself the flood damage and the clean-up. He will go up in a chopper later today to see the extent of that devastation. He's walked through the main part of town, talking to business owners and viewing for himself the incredible damage to many of their businesses. Mm. In fact, many of them still don't even have power on today. Now, he's not gone up there empty-handed. We're expecting him Prime to announce a $112 million package of grants that will go to homeowners to get their homes back up and running. As you said, $20,000 can be used to make repairs, to replace anything that's been damaged, like white goods. And it also isn't only for Lismore. The other areas that will be eligible include Ballina, Byron, Clarence Valley, Kyogle, the Richmond Valley, Tweed and the Hawkesbury. Now, the money, as I said, can be used to make homes habitable again, but the local member says that $20,000 is simply not enough, given that Queensland offered its residents $50,000. She said that would be a much more suitable amount of money to actually get things done.
Yeah, a long way to go. Thanks, Eddie. News overseas now, and a mass shooting in the United States has left six people dead and at least another 12 wounded. Let's bring in US correspondent Alison Petrowski, who is at the scene for us in Sacramento, California. Ali, what do we know right now?
Well, good morning to you, Lizzie. Multiple gunmen, as we go to air, are still on the run from police. After we saw that confronting vision, Lizzie, of that fight breaking out, witnesses tell us that a car pulled up and hundreds of rounds were fired into that crowd. Six dead, as you mentioned, 12 injured. Three men, three women, 29-year-old Devatsia Turner and 38-year-old Sergio Harris. Lizzie, we've been talking to witnesses on the ground this morning, and one of them, Aza, told us about what he saw on the street behind me in the early hours of this morning. So you heard the shots?
Yeah. It started off like a few pops. It was like, and then it went. So it was automatic for sure. I seen some people injured, like on the ground. I seen some people who were laying on the ground. Like 45 minutes after we left the alley, we were just waiting. And then once we came out, you get to see people on the ground.
Police are looking into whether or not this was a targeted attack. They are really looking at that vision of the fight, Lizzie, to try and establish whether or not it led to that shooting. California has some of the toughest gun laws in the country, but the Sacramento mayor, Daryl Steinberg, has said this morning that this is simply not enough.
How many unending tragedies does it take before we begin to cure the sickness in this country?
Lizzie, this is the deadliest shooting in Sacramento's history. It is their second mass shooting in 5 weeks, and it is the 120th mass shooting in the US so far this year.
A furious Ukrainian president has declared Russia responsible for genocide as alleged war crimes are found in recently liberated towns. And a warning, some elements of this story are distressing. More from...
Ukraine is now claiming to have retaken the whole Kyiv region. And here in the capital, people have gone days now without hearing explosions, without witnessing airstrikes. It's starting to feel a lot more comfortable. Some shops are opening up again. The alcohol ban's been lifted. But as you can see behind me, no one's convinced that Russia won't attack this city again. As Russian forces are pushed out of the region, the extent of the devastation is becoming horrifyingly clear. In the city of Bucha, north of here, the bodies of civilians line the streets, at least 20 counted on one street, and another 300 buried in a mass grave. That's according to the city's mayor. Ukraine is calling this a war crime, and the British Foreign Secretary says it should be investigated, calling the indiscriminate attacks on civilians appalling. Ukrainian soldiers have been removing bodies by attaching cables to them and pulling them from the street after warnings that retreating Russian troops were lacing the bodies of the dead with mines. Alexei Aristovich, the advisor to the president's office, has told us he believes Russia's military resources on the ground here are almost spent. He's claiming it only has enough supplies left for another fortnight or so of active combat. But he says it will likely target the south and the east next, in particular, try to take Mariupol. Russian airstrikes have now also hit Odessa. If Putin captures Odessa, he'll dominate the Black Sea, which would make negotiating for peace that much harder.
While Vladimir Putin's invasion of Ukraine has made him a pariah on the world stage, his influence is still strong with Hungary's nationalist Prime Minister, Viktor Orban. He's just defiantly declared to the rest of Europe that he has a mandate from Sunday's election result, with voters seemingly unconcerned about Budapest's close ties with Moscow. The only other pro-Putin leader in Europe, Serbia's Aleksandar Vučić, is also heading for a resounding victory and another five-year term. Formula One returns to Melbourne this weekend after 2 years of Grand Prix cancellations forced by the pandemic. Let's go live to Adam Hegarty at Albert Park for us. Adam, what's expected this weekend?
Well, Lizzie, the big promise this year is more grandstand seats and in particular more hospitality venues, for instance. But I think, as you mentioned off the top there, most people will just be happy with the race, particularly Victorians this year after 2 years worth of cancellations, because 2020 is still fresh in people's minds. People will remember, certainly Victorians do, that people were lined up, ready to go. Everything was set up. They had their tickets. They were sent away, sent home, because restrictions and lockdown was just around the corner. It really was the start of a pretty awful period here in Victoria during COVID. None of that this weekend, almost certainly, but not without its dramas. Staffing is a big issue, obviously, in hospitality in general, not just in Victoria, but across the country. Staff are furloughed when they become close contacts, and a lot's being done here to make sure that's not the case this weekend. There's a big hiring blitz for hospitality workers right up to race day, we're told, to make sure there's enough backup of workers in case people go down as close contacts.
We've had to bench a couple of people just because we can't afford our entire team to go down. Some people can work from home. It's a bit hard to give a chef a chopping board and a knife to go home with, though.
We won't exceed demand. We'll make sure that we've got enough staff to adhere to the demand that's on track.
And, Lizzie, unfortunately, another added measure will mean there will be no record crowds this year on race day on Sunday. Crowds will be capped at 130,000, but still pretty big.
That is still pretty big. Thank you, Adam. The future of French Chablis wine is in doubt as a change in weather pattern threatens vine harvest. Winemakers are lighting candles across the vineyards to prevent plunging temperatures from destroying the vintage. The frosty weather was previously unusual, but is now becoming a trend, with the weather destroying two-thirds of the harvest last year. The dry white wine is only produced in the Yonne region of Burgundy in France due to its specific climate. New South Wales taxi and rideshare passengers could soon be slugged an extra dollar per trip. The price rise would fund additional compensation for cab drivers suffering from financial hardship. The state government is considering increasing taxi compensation payments from $20,000 to $200,000. It comes after the value of taxi licences plummeted when ride-sharing services such as Uber entered the market. Holidaymakers across the country are being warned to arrive at airports early ahead of an expected Easter holiday rush. Travellers are urged to arrive at least 2 hours ahead, even before a domestic flight, with longer queues and wait times expected.